tower that we can take, take product up the tower, and the measurement mic and everything goes up with the product, and then we have a little measurement station down at the bottom of the tower, and now we can take 4 pi measurements right down to 12 hertz. And then we take that information, and every single model goes up the tower and gets this measurement done, and then you can take that into the chamber and write a correction algorithm. The chamber is only accurate to 8 hertz. So we can write a correction algorithm down to 12 hertz for each model. So now when we're doing the design work in the chamber, the base is actually accurate. It's really, really helpful. It's very difficult to piece these things together after the fact, or sort of guess out. Better up there for the real measurement.
Yep. Mm-hmm. That's one of your best subs from Axiom, the...
The EB800. This is, that part's pretty straightforward. It's a dual 12-inch. The amplifier, we manufacture the amplifier as well. It has a digital signal processor built into it. And then we just wrote the algorithms to make sure that the subwoofer itself is actually perfectly linear from 12 hertz to 150 hertz. In a 4 pi environment, which is really the key to sound is what its measurement is in a 4 pi environment. Whether you do that in the chamber or outside the tower, it doesn't matter. But really, the key to good sound is understanding what happens in a 4 pi environment, and then it will work in the room. We are not fans of room correction, obviously. So what you want to do is bring the performance into your room. It's really the key. You don't want to sort of start playing around with the frequency response. If you brought a live person playing a piano or a guitar into your room, you would start adjusting the frequency response to it. You just enjoy the performance in your room. And this is sort of a recent addition here. We've taken all of our larger models, the M60 and 80, and center channels, and made on-wall versions of them. Basically, in a theater system where you've got subwoofers running, you don't need the larger cabinet space that the sort of floor stander or this version of the center channel has. So you're going to sacrifice some bass in an on-wall, but that's about it. You're going to cross it over to the subwoofer anyway, so you're putting a bit more load on your subwoofer. You can always just get another sub. It's the right thing to do anyway. And what else should we cover?
Yeah, I think pretty much everything can be customized to a different living room or a furniture that you want to match. That's one facility we have with Axiom is, if there's a transition period, but if we have enough time and there's a furniture we need to match with the speakers that are going to go in the living room, we can match the...
Even the dimensions part of it? The dimensions required to go with the screen or something, availability of
screen,
the dimensions be
altered or not? Yeah. Yeah, we do that a lot, actually. So you would take something like this and then extend it so that it matches the width of the TV. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, we're doing that quite a bit. It's really the only thing you can't do that with is like something like this, where this is a plastic, that's plastic injection molded cabinet. And obviously we can't make another tool to make one speaker. But when you're talking about the wooden cabinets, and we have our own cabinet factory, so yeah, we can make dimensional adjustments. I mean, there's a time factor involved.
Yes.
You've got to get from Canada to here.
Yes.
You know, other than that, it's no problem. Yeah.
Any questions?
I just had a curious question. How closely are the tolerances followed between the prototype and the production models?
They're exact.
Really?
Yeah, we are really big into consistency.
That, you know, it's interesting. I didn't even think of it until you brought it up. But
it's an enormous deal in the production of loudspeakers.
You know, not so much in electronics. I mean, you're, unless you change your circuit board, it's going to perform like your sound.
But
speakers do not perform the same, is the bottom line. Consistency is a very, very difficult thing to achieve.
So we've made it a huge priority over the years. And in fact, it's the whole reason we got into making our own drivers. Because we wanted a consistency level that was just simply nobody was going to do it. So everything is measured. We have another little mini chamber right on our assembly line. And all the product goes through this little mini chamber. It's all automated, so it goes in automatically. And there's little sensors that stop it at the right point, so it's in the right spot, and the door is closed. It runs a series of measurements. It does an amplitude response, and does an impedance curve, and does a rubber bud, buzz and phase. So that we know that every speaker is exactly like the one that was designed in the big chamber. And, you know, we set up the little chamber with one that was measured in the big chamber. And then tests are done on this. Things are reset up on this on a regular schedule, so we're always sure that everything getting produced is exactly like the original design. Because in the speaker world, virtually nothing. That's the bottom line. It just isn't. Variation is enormous and nobody really knows, because if you go to a speaker factory, what you'll notice is that they're basically putting a little sign sweep through it and somebody's listening to make sure that
it's working.
It's working. And out it goes, right? There's nothing to sort of say, well, is that really anything like the original design? So yeah, we put a lot of effort. Big deal.